Greeting, folks, in the name of our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. This is Russell Shepherd. I'm the pastor of Grace Gospel Fellowship in Ann Arbor. The beginning of the credits, when you saw the name of the program, Grace to You, as well as other credits of the producer, you saw a phone number there. That's our number to reach the church. And also, at the end of the program, if you want additional information, we'd like to come out and fellowship with us. There's an email address to contact us or contact us with the church phone number because we meet every other Sunday at 2 o'clock at the Church of the Good Shepherd. Well, we study these things that you see us doing during the broadcast. Folks, God's designed in His Word, and God did write His Word, and He preserved His Word, and He's kept it. God's design in His Word through the ministry of God the Holy Spirit is to begin with basic Bible instruction. The terminology that's used in the Bible is to go from milk to meat. So when we're in the book of Romans, and what Paul calls the gospel of the grace of God, Acts chapter 20, verse 24, he says, "None of these things move me, neither count of my life dear to myself, that I might finish my course with joy in the ministry I received the Lord Jesus to testify of the gospel of the grace of God." There are different synonyms used for Paul's message. Sometimes he calls it the gospel of God. And verse number 16 calls it the gospel of Christ. Verse 1, he calls it the gospel of God. In Acts chapter 20, verse 24, he calls it the gospel of the grace of God. They're all synonymous terms for the same message. That in Romans chapter 16, and we've studied this, when the Apostle Paul starts to talk about his distinctive ministry and revelation that he received from the Lord Jesus Christ, where he says, "Now to him there's a power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest, and by the scriptures of the prophets made known to all nations for the obedience of faith." When Paul begins to talk about his message in verse number 11, he talks about establishment. But in verse chapter 16, verse number 25 and 26, he talks about establish. There are two different words in the English. One is to build that basic milk doctrine establishment. In other words, when you go through the book of Romans, what's happening and the design by God the Holy Spirit about the ministry committed to Paul, about the gospel of the grace of God, about who Jesus Christ is today, goes from milk in the book of Romans all the way over to meat in the book of Ephesians. And it's the pillars that are laid to help perfect you. When you go through Romans, there's four sections. And the first section of the gospel of Christ and our new identity in Christ deals with the issue of the wrath of God. And so we started to talk about that issue in verse number 18 in our last message. If you see on the board, this is lesson number 10 in Romans chapter 1, the wrath of God 2. So when Paul begins to talk about his distinctive ministry and message, it starts with the revelation of God's wrath. And the reason he deals with the issue of the issue of the revelation of God's wrath, that's his justice, folks. That's his holiness. That's his vindication of sin. That he's a pure eye, as Habakkuk 1 says, that he can't look upon evil. God Almighty, in his nature, in his character, is not like us. God is holy, absolute, total holiness. God is a God of justice. He always does right. You know that verse that Abraham said when God Almighty was going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah in Genesis chapter 19. He says, "Shall not the God of all the earth do right?" And he does. God always does what's right. So one of the things he has to do because he's God is he can't acquit sin. Sin has to be dealt with. Now you and I will, you know, the term they use, sweep sin under the rug, keep things in the closet. I don't know how many people I've met that when they talk about their past life, they call them, you know, you call them skeletons in the closet. People don't want to share with you who and what they are. But by folks, by nature, we all share the same nature as Adam. So you're just like me, and I'm just like you, in terms of our makeup, in terms of how sin has affected us. We were born in this world, according to the book of Psalms, born in trespasses and sin. We all have the same nature that we received from our parents, specifically from the Father. Adam passed his new nature, which was a sin nature, onto his children. We're going to see that in a minute. he passed on a ungodly nature, but that's not the way God created him. God created him in what they call innocent. When God created Adam and Eve, he created them in his image and likeness. And yet when Adam sinned, and he brought sin into the world, according to Romans chapter 5, he then brought death by sin. So death passed upon all men, for all have sinned. And in Romans chapter 3, he says, we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. The Bible says, there's not a just man upon the earth that doeth good and sinneth not. So you and I are born sinners. That's why we sin. It's our nature, according to Ephesians chapter 2. We were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. You know, my pastor used to say something that was kind of comical, but I'll pass it on to you. He says, a dog barks because he's a dog, and a bird flies because he's a bird. We sin because we're sinners. So the issue of the gospel of Christ is how can you have an old nature and get a new nature? Well, it's all through the redemption that's in Christ Jesus. And when you get saved today, that is, you get justified, God takes you out of Adam, the old nature, and he puts you in Christ and gives you a new nature. He doesn't make the old one better. He gives you a new nature. He gives you a brand new nature, folks, but it's not on the outside. Religion gives you a nature that deals with the outside. When God creates something, he creates it brand new. He's the creator. So that wonderful verse in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I know you know it, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. So what God's doing today in what the Bible calls the dispensation of the grace of God, he's forming a new creation. He's forming what the Bible calls the one new man. It's a spiritual man. And yet he hasn't changed the outer man. That's my body, you see. He's changed my inner man. That's where I go live today. He's created, he birthed my spirit that was dead. The spirit that, when I was born in this world, my spiritual life, which connected to God, was my inner man, it's called. And then he gave me, he birthed my spirit, he born me into his family, and he gave me a new nature. But the new nature is inside, it's not outside. I'll get a new body one day. That's later on. That's at the rapture. But today I have old nature. So you'll see believers sometimes look like the old man, and they have a new man. They haven't been perfected. They haven't learned how to walk in the Spirit according to Scriptures. They haven't learned how to walk in their new identity. So that's what the book of Romans is. It's milk doctrine to establish us in this new identity that starts with the revelation of God's wrath. Now, that's verse 18. That's where we'll start today, where Paul says, before he tells you about God's righteousness, verse 17, God Almighty is going to reveal the perfect standard that his justice requires, that those who don't meet that standard receive his wrath. And by the way, let me say this before I start. That's so you and I can know the predicament that we're in. I thought about today is on January the 31st. We're going into a new year, and it's said that if you have smoke detectors, you should test the batteries as you go into this new year to see if they still work, right? The reason we do that is because if there's a fire in the house, if something, you know, catches fire, and my wife and I are in bed and we don't know there's a fire, we need a detector to tell us, fire! Let us know it's time to get out the house, to call somebody to help us, to get us out of our predicament. Or a neighbor might come along and knock on the door or holler and tell us, it's a fire. But folks, if we didn't know it was a fire, we couldn't call out for help or respond to the call for help. So the wrath of God tells you there's a fire. The issue of the fire is the wrath of God is a revelation of the righteous judgment of God that ends in a lake of fire. So what Paul calls, is given the responsibility to do, and I am too today, is tell you that God has a fire. That is appointed unto men once to die, and after death comes the fire, the judgment. So you want to escape the wrath of God, folks, by trusting in Christ, who on Calvary's cross suffered the wrath of God for you, so you don't have to go there. He took your place. And the only way you can receive God's righteousness, the only way you can escape the wrath of God, is as a free gift. Can't work for it. The price for sin has already been paid for. The debt and penalty, notice this, the debt and penalty for sin has been paid for through the redemption that's in Christ Jesus. And when you trust him, then the righteousness of God is imputed to you. So the wrath of God doesn't come along and have to judge you. Verse 18, When Paul starts talking about the revelation of the gospel of Christ, he doesn't start with righteousness, he starts with wrath. And let me say this to you. He's going to take from verse 1 and 18 of chapter 1 of Romans, all the way over to Romans chapter 3, verse 20, and that whole section is going to deal with the revelation of the righteous judgment of God. And it's going to start with talking about why God Almighty, why men deserve the wrath of God, why it's meted or earned. Now, let me say this to you, too. Children that are born who die, folks, according to the scriptures, when David lost his son, and after he realized his son wasn't coming back, he said, I shall go to him, but he shall not return to me. And God Almighty is just that he doesn't, his justice doesn't come against children who die innocently. That doesn't happen. Or people that might have mental health issues. But you and I who make conscious decisions about sin, then that's where God's wrath is going to be revealed. So let me make that clear. God is just, but God's a God of mercy, and he's a good God. So verse number 18, when he starts talking about the wrath of God, I want you to see the two things we left off with last time. Number one, the wrath of God is revealed from against all ungodliness. That's verse 18. And it's revealed against all unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. And that's where God's wrath is going to be revealed against men who reject his truth. Now, the truth in the passage, as we go down to verse number, and the next several weeks, we'll go from verse number 18 to down to verse 32. The issue is when men had the revelation of God about God revealed himself to be the creator of heaven and earth. What they did is they took that revelation and the satanic policy of evil came along and produced a counterfeit where in verse number 25 it says, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worship and serve the creature more than the creator who's blessed forever, amen. Now, you know, I thought about, should I do this, folks? We just got through with some festivals, a series of festivals. And part of the festivals are related to that verse in verse number 25. When men in Genesis chapter 11, the historical account of the nations, when they saw the Creator and they knew him, they rejected him as Creator. And instead of accepting the Creator, the truth of God, they accepted the lie program, the one of the devil, the adversary, and the counterfeit that he created from that. And that's another lesson. But what I want to do is go down through the passage, verse 19, because that which may be known of God is manifested in them. Now, we've talked these series before on the faith of Christ, but I want you to see something, because we're dealing with milk doctrine, because that which may be known of God is manifested. Notice what it says, in them. That's the issue of conscience. God has created every person that's born in this world, he's given them a conscience. That conscience tells you that there is a creator. But watch what they do. For God has showed it on them. Now, that's the second witness, which is creation. So God creates an internal witness that he's God, he's a creator. And then the second revelation is the revelation of creation, that you see the sun, the moon, the stars. You know that somebody created that, and it wasn't evolution. It was a creator who did that. And that's Genesis chapter 1 and 2. But watch what he says. For he explains there's a further illustration of the issue of why God's going to judge men. Verse 20, for the invisible things of him. Notice that there's some things that's invisible of God from the creation of the world. Do you see that? The invisible things of him. He expands on verse number 19, for God has showed it unto them, by showing that the invisible things of the world are, watch this, clearly seen. And then he goes on to say, being understood by the things that are made. Now notice this. The invisible things of God, the fact that there's a God, there's a creator who's in the invisible God, he's called. He's a spirit being, created the physical realm. And they're clearly seen. And they understood the nature of God could be understood, the fact he's creator, the verse says, by the things that are made. Now watch this. Even his eternal power and Godhead, so they're without excuse. Now the issue of the Godhead, folks, in the Bible, is God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. They're called the Godhead. It's three times that reference appears. So the issue of God being manifested, one God manifested in three separate distinct persons, is the Godhead. And we'll see that when we get back to Genesis chapter 1. But the issue, when they rejected God, folks, they rejected God the Father, they rejected God the Son, and they rejected God the Holy Spirit with ungodliness. Now, the definition for ungodliness, folks, verse number 18, when it says, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness." The issue of ungodliness is the opposite of godliness. So when you understand what the definition is for godliness, you understand what ungodliness is. So the definition for godliness, and we're going to see this in a minute, is that you think like God, you walk in his ways, and you labor together with him. That's godliness. You think like God the Father, you labor, you walk like God the Son, and you labor, co-labor together with God the Holy Spirit. Now, when we go down through Romans chapter 1, verse 24 to 32, you'll see that God the Father gives the nations up because of ungodliness, God the Son gives the nations up because of ungodliness, and God the Holy Spirit gives them up. So the nature, the creation, the Gentile nations in Genesis chapter 11 are given over to Satan, who's the most ungodly creature in the whole universe. Because he didn't think like God the Father, he didn't do what God the Son did in his original creation as Lucifer, and he didn't co-labor together with God the Holy Spirit. By the way, that's why you have a body, a soul, and a spirit. With your spirit, you can communicate with God the Father. With your soul, you communicate with God the Son, and with your body, you co-labor with God the Holy Spirit. Now, when men became ungodly, then their spiritual life, their spirit was darkened. It was alienated, the Bible says. It was separated from the life of God, Ephesians 4. So, matter of fact, if you go down through the passage, in verse number 21, because that which may be known of God, I'm sorry, because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were they thankful, but watch this, but became vain in their imaginations. And the rest of the verse says, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professed themselves to be wise, they became fools. You see the issue of the heart there? The heart in the Bible is compared to, it's where the soul, the heart is the mentality of the soul. It has a thinking capacity. You know, the verse says, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. So it's not talking about your pumping organ. It's talking about the soul, where your conscience lies. That's where God created every individual with a soul that's unique and different. Now, we can share body parts. You know that. So our bodies are made from the dust of the earth. In Genesis chapter 2, when he created Adam, he created from the dust of the earth. He breathed in his nostril the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Those entities, the spirit, the soul, and the body, they're separate. Hebrews chapter 4 says the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than a two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of your heart. So the Bible separates the spirit from the soul and from the body. But it takes the soul and the spirit and the body for you to be complete. So when God Almighty gave the revelation of himself in creation, and the Godhead was rejected, it says, so they are without excuse. That means everybody is without excuse, folks. You have a conscience in you that tells you there's a God. You have the revelation of God in creation that tells you there's a God. And if men would seek after God, they would happily find him. But you know what they do? They become God. They reject the revelation of God, and men in their wickedness say, I'm God. And so they sit on their throne, their self-righteous nature, their self-centeredness, that men try to run their own lives, men and women, folks. And we call it pride and rebellion. And if you're like me, and I'm like you, we've all experienced that, where we try to run our own life, and typically, well, I only say typically without counsel, but you know what happens when I do that? I mess up things. And guess what? So do you. So God Almighty, in his mercy and his love, wants me to understand that he's a God of not only creation, but he's a God of eternal wisdom. And all I need to do is just follow him and be obedient to what he tells me to do so I can avoid the pitfalls. Not of just what the Bible calls the sufferings of this present time. Men go through suffering, folks, because of Adam's sin. Not because you've done anything bad or good. Because in the age of grace, 2 Corinthians 5 says, God is not imputing your trespasses against you. Now, what do you mean by that, Pastor Shepherd? That means that when things happen as bad in your life, folks, it's just because you're in a world of sin. And I'm not saying there's not times that you do things that are foolish, that you reap what you sow. But even if you don't do things that are foolish, you still have the natural consequences of sin in this planet. And there's a reason for that. It's the long-suffering of God that allows men to go on in their wicked ways and rebel against God. And so the long-suffering of God, matter of fact, if you go back to verse number 7, remember we read that verse in Romans chapter 1, it says, to all that be in Rome, beloved of God. No, remember we talked about that term, beloved, there it is there. Beloved of God, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. That verse just told me that God's official attitude towards ungodly men and sinners is grace and peace. Now watch what it says, from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And by the way, when Paul's writing the book of Romans, he's writing to saints, not sinners. So I said last week that God the Father said about God the Son, this is my beloved Son in whom I well pleased. Verse number 7, he calls the saints, matter of fact, there's two things, to all that be in Rome, beloved of God, call to be saints. Folks, in a religious system, there are people who have to die, and it has to be authenticated that they did all these good works years later, and then somebody has the authority to make them a saint. That's not the Bible, saints. That's this system over here in Romans chapter 1, verse 25. It's a lie program. The way you become a saint is by being taken out of Adam by God the Holy Spirit and put into Christ. And you have the same identity of Jesus Christ today as a new creature. So the first thing you have to know about, and I have to know about, is the fact that God's wrath today is being delayed. Now, I want to talk about that now. I want to talk about the components of ungodliness. So come with me in your Bible to Genesis chapter 1, where we go to the original creation. And I don't think I've said this in quite a while, but folks, the Bible sets up its own terms and definitions. You don't have to go to some book of theology or some other reference point. You get a concordance out and run the verses, but the Bible is its own, it sets up its own definitions and own terms. It's a scientific textbook, but as you learn how to study it, you go get different verses to explain to you a verse that you're reading. So when we go to Genesis chapter 1, it's going to explain the issue of how God created Adam and the issue of an image and a likeness. Verse number 26. And God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness. Now, let me stop there because there's so much doctrine in this verse. But when we read in Romans chapter 1 about the Godhead, you see in verse number 26 where he says, let us make man. Folks, the issue of us is a plural term. It's not I, it's us. So that means there's more than one entity involved here, and that's God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. That's the Godhead. When they make man in their own image, watch what it says, our image and after our likeness. Now, the image is a physical image. The likeness is a spiritual likeness. So when God made Adam in his image, it was a physical image, a physical representation, like a shadow. It wasn't God, and he wasn't creator, but they made him in their image. And it's the reason for this. And they made them, watch this, after our likeness. Now, the issue of the likeness there has to do with that component of thinking like God the Father, walking in the ways of God the Son, and laboring together with God the Holy Spirit. That Adam was created to be a spirit-like being that represented on this earth God's image and likeness. Now, verse 27, so God created man in his own image, in the image of God, he created to him, he created he him, and male and female, male he created he them. That's the original creation, folks. And then it goes on to say about God blessing them and said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. And that's a whole nother subject there. But in Genesis chapter 3, man sinned. And man's created in God's likeness, he was created to be a God-like man. Listen to that, he was created to be a God-like man. But he sinned. He disobeyed God. And when he did that, he entered the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And Adam, when he sinned, he became ungodly. He didn't think like God the Father. He didn't walk like God the Son. And he didn't co-labor together with God the Holy Spirit. And so he became ungodly. That makes sense. So in Genesis chapter 5, watch what he says, verse 1. Genesis 5, verse 1. And we're going to have to stop because my time's gone out again. And when we start again, we'll go back to Romans chapter 1. So he says, this is the book of the generations of Adam. Now he references back, Moses does, to Genesis chapter 1. In the day that God created man. By the way, to people that don't believe in the issue of creation, the verse that either, I have a friend that says, either you're a believer or you're not. Now, if you believe the witness of men, the witness of God is greater. And God's not a man that he shall lie. So if you believe that God Almighty created man, then you're lining up with God. If you believe that man evolved from something that was here, from the tadpole or fish or monkeys or apes, then you reject this issue about God being creator. Is that simple enough? You either believe the Bible or you don't. If you don't believe the Bible, just cut off the TV. But if you do, thank God for you. Because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. I believe this verse, that God Almighty created the heavens and the earth. Now, when we get back to Romans chapter 1, you're going to see that the first thing the Gentile nations did, they rejected God as the creator. So he says, God created man in the likeness of God, made he him. I'm in verse number 1. Male and female, he created he them, and blessed them, and called their name Adam, Mr. and Mrs. Adam, in the day that they were created. Now watch this, verse 33. And Adam lived 130 years and begot sons in his own likeness after his image and called his name Seth. And then if you look down to verse 5, and all the days of Adam lived were 930 years and he died. See, God's purpose was to create a man who lived forever. But when man sinned, he didn't have access to the tree of life that he can live forever. And when Adam sinned, the reason God put him out of the garden is because he would have made a line of sinners who would never die. Because in verse number 3, he begot a son in his own image and his own likeness, not the image of God. Now, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. God then Almighty, through the work of Christ at Calvary, will make you into a new creation. He's making brand new beings, taking them out of Adam, putting them in Christ. Folks, my time is out. And, you know, there's just so much information here that you can't exhaust it all. But this is Pastor Russell Shepherd commending the word of God to you. If you're lost today and you've never trusted Jesus Christ to be your Savior, today is the day of salvation. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. At the end of the program, there's credits and there's an email address. Please reach out to us. Let us know you're watching the program, good or bad. And then let us know how to get information to you about our program and our meetings. Folks, we're teaching some things and giving some things out about understanding Israel's program. I don't know if you can see that or not. It's small. But it's the doctrine of the benefits of understanding Israel's program. We've offered other things free. So just contact us and we can get some information to you. This is Pastor Russell Shepherd from Grace Bible Fellowship, saying Maranatha.